So today we are going to speak about the Angular elements, or more in detail, like the best way to how to lazy load them. But first, before we start, like quick introduction. So my name is Thomas Trajan. I guess most of you know me because like, yeah, from Zurich and Zurich community, but who knows? Then I'm like a Google developer expert for Angular. I'm working in Switzerland as a contractor with various enterprises, working on open source, blogging, and giving workshops and training about Angular. So feel free to chat with me later if you are interested. Anyway, before we start, like, let's put ourselves a bit into a context, because like elements is this thing which like most of us heard about, but I guess like not everybody is using in day-to-day job. So let's build a bit context around it, and then we proceed like to this lazy loading. So let's start with like evolution of the concept on the web. So in the beginning, like many years ago, more than 15, I don't know, we have been writing, some of us, vanilla JavaScript applications. So what does that mean? We have been using like built-in HTML elements like button or input or form, and then we were writing like some JavaScript, maybe even like in a website, maybe also in a script. So spaghetti equals true, and we were doing like bindings by hand manually and stuff like this. And then we realized that maybe this is not the best way of building web. So then we were like, okay, how can we make this stuff easier? And we were like, components. But the components are not provided by the web itself. There are like no native components, or at least wasn't at the time. So the community came up like with various libraries and frameworks, like with Backbone, Dojo, and then AngularJS, Vue, Ember, many, to handle these problems. So what is a component if you think about it? If we take like a native HTML tag like P, like for paragraph, so what can it do? It can show text. Maybe it can use some styling, like it's bold and it's a red color. Maybe even can be animated if you get really fancy, like with some CSS transition. Compared to that, something like a real component can of course do all these things, but this is just the beginning. Like if we use like, let's say for example, AngularJS or Angular, the possibilities are like almost limitless, right? So we can do stuff like toggling it, we can assign it to a user, we can set a deadline on the to-do item, we can tag them and filter them. Anything, basically possibilities are endless. So that's like much more powerful compared to like built-in HTML elements. So if we want to summarize, the good stuff about the component is that they are reusable. So if we once implement to-do item with all these interactions, we can use it in many places in our application without need to bind like all these events like in every place we use it. So that means these things are encapsulated inside of the component, and because of that, we can reduce the complexity of our application. That means we hide this complexity in that component, but then the complexity of the application because of that goes down, because we don't have to handle all these things. But the disadvantages are that components were for a very long time framework or library specific, which means that if we, let's say, implemented like component library in AngularJS, we cannot really reuse it like in React or Ember or like in new Angular, maybe with like some hacky approach, and it would be like very heavy in terms of payload. So it's not really a way to go. So people were like, okay, we really like these components. It's really helping us, but they are not native. We cannot reuse them. They kind of like get obsolete. So what if we came up with the native components? This will solve our problems, right? Kinda. So if we want to write like nowadays a web component, it's kind of simple. We can just extend the HTML element, and we just defined the tag, so some element, and we pass in that element, and we can start using that tag on our website. So this looks kind of simple, but it gets pretty crazy very fast. So this long code, you don't even need to read it, but basically it handles a web component which can accept two attributes. It's called disabled and open, so it's like some toggle or something. So the problem with this is, again, similar as previously, with previous development of vanilla web applications, that it's like very low-level DOM API. We have to manually manage reflection of the properties and attributes because this is not handled for us. We have to manually handle lifecycle hooks and registering of the click events and deregistering so we don't get like memory leaks. We can only pass in primitive values by default into attributes, so nothing like what we are used to from Angular, that we can pass in arrays of objects of arbitrary complexity. And if we want to like notify the parent applications, the custom events can be pretty verbose comparing to like emitting an event on an output in Angular. Also, it's usually like less declarative compared to real frameworks where we have to get hold of the element and then we maybe call some methods on it. So that's really not that great. But there are some good things about web components, of course. So they are more reusable because they are framework independent. Then that means we can really, if we really build a proper component library using web components, then we can easily use it in projects with React, with Angular, with Svelte, wherever, because they are just HTML elements. So if our framework can work with button, it can also work with to-do item. And they also provide us with better encapsulation, because nowadays in modern browser we can use like Shadow DOM, so we get a real encapsulation of CSS, for example. And in theory can be future-proof because of this, that we can use it even in the frameworks which are still yet to come, some new stuff. We will probably work with that too. So entering Angular elements. So why Angular elements? The thing is, we want to write Angular because it's just much more powerful and much more high level, but we want to get web components. So that's kind of like the same approach as in the beginning. We were writing vanilla applications, and then we realized this would be much easier using frameworks. So why not do the same for the web components? And of course, there are more frameworks and libraries. So it's not just Angular which enables us to do that. There is like Stencil and Svelte and whatever. But we are at the Angular meetup, and we can easily use Angular to do the same. So what about Angular elements? So of course, all the advantages of the web components also apply here. So like this reusability and Shadow DOM and stuff. But besides that, we are using a powerful framework to do that with all these higher level abstractions, which are very powerful and help us. And of course, we are writing much less code because it's higher level. And we can leverage all the already existing community tools, resources, articles. There is like many existing component frameworks for Angular. We can leverage all these things. Use cases. So why would we want to work with Angular elements? So first, like the most trendy one is like microfrontend. So basically, our application is a collection of many applications. We can mix and match it. But this is maybe not so realistic in most big organizations because it's like hard to move into. So what is more interesting is like sub-applications. So let's say our organization has like many, many applications. Like currently at the insurance company where I work, we have like 84 SPAs. And many of those applications, they will have like reuse some of the components which is used very often. For example, like a document editor or like a whatever task for the employees. And now imagine we want to reuse it in all these applications. So we would have to implement a library. And when we release a new version of this library, for example, from version 1 to version 1.1, in that case, we would need to also release and redeploy all these consumer applications because they have to rebuild to get the new version, right? So this can lead to problems because I highly doubt that like a big organization have such a great continuous delivery platform that they deploy like 10 times a day 80 applications. So there is like some legacy stuff, maybe some is deployed once a week, some is like once a month, some is once a day. So you easily can get a situation when you have like a different version of the same component. And this can be handled by element, because if you have an element, you can like serve it on a web. And basically these applications, they can reference it just with the URL and always get the latest element without the needs to redeploy. The last use case could be like heavy components. So sometimes you want to use like some very heavy rich text editor, but you don't need to use it straight ahead. So maybe it's only after user interaction, like an inline edit. And in that case, I mean, in Angular, you can do lazy loading of components, but it's not so like developer friendly, and it's much easier to do with elements. Okay, let's give a closer look at the elements now. Just a second. Right. So, what are elements? In the end, what the element is a normal Angular SPA. There is just like a small difference that we are using this create custom element helper from Angular Elements. And during the bootstrap, we don't bootstrap the application, but we wrap the component using that function create custom element. And that way we get the elements. So with all this kind of like boilerplate, which we showed previously about the properties and attributes and lifecycle, this is all done for us. So we can just write a plain Angular component and it will wrap it as an element for us. After that, we again have to use like the browser API to use that element and define the tag for it, and then we can use it. So how can we use it? So first of all, before we can use it, we have to build it. So to build it, we can use the Angular CLI because it's a normal Angular SPA, But it would be much easier if instead of like multiple files, which we get by default, like there is this main and polyfills and whatever, it would be much easier if we just get like a single file. And for that, we can use the NGX build plus library from Manfred Steyer. So this library basically replaces the default Angular builders in the Angular JSON with his builder and enables us to use this single bundle flag together with output hashing none. And this will give us basically this pure one file, which we call like main.js by default. And this is very nice because that way we can reference our element as a single file. So how can we use it? So in any random web app, no, doesn't need to be Angular, we can always just include a script tag in a head and this will register our element and suddenly we can use it anywhere in the body, no problem. This will just work. How can we use it in Angular? The same way we can add it in the script, in the beginning, in the head, then we have some application, and later inside of that application, we can like in template, we can use like some element, and then we can also do like a bindings and like event bindings, and this will all work the same way as we are used to like with other Angular components, so that's very cool. And this will just work out of the box. But this is still eagerly loaded, so it will like, increase our load time, so this is not something which we would like. So, and we need to make it lazy. And to do that, I actually created like open source library, which gives us this directive, Angular extension lazy element, where we can pass in this URL of the element from where it's served, and this will load it lazily only once we want to first time to render that element. So if it's in some component which is only routed to later, it will only be downloaded and rendered when we route to that component. Or if it's in a component which is displayed from the start, but there is like an ngif condition, so it's actually not shown yet, it will only be downloaded when it was really rendered, when the condition in ngif was set to true. So what does it do? It started with the star, if you remember. There was like this star in the beginning. So that means it's a structural directive. So that means it removes that element from the DOM because we don't have the bundle yet. Then it adds a script tag to the body to download the element bundle. And after that, it waits until it's loaded. And when it's loaded, it adds element back to DOM. So this already makes it work, but it's even better because during the loading, you can provide a template with the loading animation or like a text. Also, if it fails, you can provide like a nice user-friendly error message. And it also guarantees that one element will be always loaded only one time, even though you used it multiple times in your multiple components or even in a single component, because it has like a built-in registry of elements and it tracks which URLs were already downloaded. Right, so now quickly, lessons learned. The only problem with this is related to zone. So if you can write your elements new from scratch, the best way to do it is without zone and with manual change detection. But if you want to reuse the old elements, the best way to do it is basically to share the parent application Angular zone, hang it on a window, and then pass it to element during its bootstrap. Like I opened the issue on the Git, on GitHub on Angular repo related to this, and basically one core maintainer of zone.js recommended this approach, so we can then discuss later. Besides that, be careful with ngzone run outside of Angular. This can also mess up your change detection. So you can use it, but you just have to split the streams. And use etags. Because we have basically this single main.js file, so we are not having a hash in the file name, so to let the browser know that we have a new version of our element, this server needs to support etag. So etag kind of calculates the hash behind the scenes and notifies the application when there was a new version. So that way you can have a statically linked these elements, and the applications will keep getting new versions without any need to redeploy. Right, so to learn more, we don't have much time, so we will hang the slides on the Meetup page so you can check it out, but it's official documentation, the library and stuff. Yeah, if you want to get in touch, we can also, the slides will be shared, or you can install me in your console, and if you have a good console, then you maybe even can click on the links and open them in a browser. So you will get this, so that's kind of cool. And thank you for your attention.